We start off by considering the problem of computing instantaneous velocity. Average velocity is the change in position divided by the change in time. Suppose you were driving down the highway and you glanced at your odometer at 1 o'clock and saw it read 1523. Then you glanced at it again at 3 o'clock and saw it read 1645. Then your average velocity for these 2 hours would come out to be 61 miles per hour. You probably weren't going 61 miles per hour the entire time. Probably sometimes you were going a little faster, sometimes you were going a little slower. You can get a more accurate picture of your velocity by looking at your odometer more often, taking the average over shorter intervals. Let's say you also looked at your odometer at 1:40 to see that it read 1567, and at 2 o'clock it read 1577. From 1 o'clock to 1:40, in that two-thirds of an hour, you were traveling an average of 66 miles per hour. From 1:40 to 2 o'clock, you only went 10 miles, which means that in that one-third of an hour, your average speed was just 30 miles per hour. Finally, from 2 to 3 o'clock, you went 68 miles in 1 hour. Overall, you were mostly going faster than that 61, and there was just this one shorter period where you were going slower, maybe you hit traffic or something. To get the most accurate picture, you'd like to look at an interval of length 0. You'd like to look at a single instant. But then in our formula here, if your start and end times are equal, the change in time would be 0, and the change in position would also be 0. We can't calculate 0 over 0, so how can we actually get to this instantaneous velocity? The two big notions in calculus, derivatives and integrals, are both based on the same idea. If you don't know how to calculate something exactly, then you should approximate it. And you should approximate it better and better. As your error goes to 0, your approximations are approaching the truth. And that idea of approaching is what limits are all about. So here, as we have those shorter and shorter time intervals, we're getting closer and closer to the true instantaneous velocity because we're approximating it better and better with an average velocity that's more and more accurate. Galileo discovered that if you drop a ball from a tall building, in t seconds, it will fall 4.9 times t squared meters. This means the ball is not falling at a constant speed. The distance it travels in 1 second changes depending on which second you're looking at. Since the speed is changing, one might wonder how to figure out what it is at a given time. So, how fast is it falling after 1 second? We can use the same strategy as we did for the car. We should see how far it's gone in shorter and shorter intervals. And when those intervals get really, really short, we'll get a really good estimate. So we start with a biggish interval, 0 to 1. In that 1 second, the ball travels 4.9 meters, so the average speed is 4.9 meters per second. Now we want a smaller interval that's closer to the target time of 1 second, so we look at, say, 0.5 to 1. We calculate the distance at 1 second, which is 4.9 meters, the distance at 0.5 seconds, so that would be 4.9 times 0.5 squared. Then we take their difference and divide by the change in time, and it works out to be 7.35 meters per second. How about an even smaller interval? As the interval gets smaller and smaller near 1, the value starts to stabilize. We can see now it's sort of 9 point something big, 9.7, 9.8, something like that. If we look at an interval of just 1/10,000th of a second, we get 9.79951 meters per second. Since our interval is so tiny, we think this is probably a pretty good estimate. We could also look at a tiny interval after 1 second. In the interval after 1 second, of length 1/10,000th of a second, the average speed is also about 9.8. So this is pretty good evidence that the answer is 9.8. What's happening here graphically? When we calculate an average speed, we're actually looking at the slope of something called a secant line. So here's the graph of Galileo's equation, 4.9 t squared. And when I take any two points on this graph, represented here in purple, and draw a line through them, that's called a secant line. The slope of this secant line is the change in distance between the two points, the change in f, divided by the change in time. Well, change in distance divided by change in time, that's exactly what we were doing to calculate average speed. And we can see here for these two points, the change in distance is 4.9, the change in time is 1, so we're getting the slope represented here as m. M equals 4.9. You can see it there in the left panel. And as I move this point here closer to 1, that slope m is increasing and getting close to 9.8. Same thing if I move that other point to the right and then bring it in closer and closer and closer, m is going to still approach that 9.8 that we calculated. Wherever these two points are, we have some secant line for the graph, and by moving the two points closer together, by narrowing that interval where we calculate the average speed, what we're really doing is making the secant line more and more what's called a tangent line. You might remember from geometry where you had lines tangent to a circle. It kind of means that the line is just barely touching the curve, and it's at that point, it's almost parallel to the curve. So the slope of this tangent line is going to be sort of an instantaneous slope of the curve. It's going to represent that instantaneous velocity that we were looking for. This idea of tangent lines and instantaneous velocity is going to be developed more in Chapter 3. That's really the foundational idea behind derivatives. We really need to develop this idea of limits before we can have derivatives, and eventually at the end of the class, we'll see that the idea of integration is also really about limits too. Please go on to the next video where we'll talk about limits in more generality outside of this instantaneous velocity problem.